Part 2. San Juan de Ortega. There are memorials all along the path, some professionally constructed, others little more than simple wooden crosses erected to the memory of a pilgrim. They are all attended to in one way or another as pilgrims pass them by. Most have flowers, wilting or dead, some plastic attached to them or stuck into pots or jars at their foot. Many have photographs of the deceased or of close relatives. Nearly all have messages pinned to them by friends or by others of the same nationality as the dead. The memorials are pushed back into hedges, stand proudly in front of walls, or look out from the top of a small rise or hill. They are an occasional distraction on the walk. Most pilgrims stop to look, many say a small prayer, and there are often short services said and blessings given by a local priest in exchange for a small donation to the nearest church. The one Julia stopped by was just west of San Juan de Ortega, 11 days into the walk, around 250 kilometres from Saint-Jean-Pied-de-Port, and not long before Burgos, the second major city on the path. This memorial was one of the simpler kind, in front of a stone wall under an oak tree. It was a wooden cross about 4 feet high, with the usual messages pinned all over it, some tied with string, others stuffed in cracks, and a few older ones attached with a rotting red ribbon. At first she thought it was German, then looking more carefully at the name, Van Hoogen, she decided it was Dutch. It was hot, and the oak offered shade, so she dumped her pack and picked up a brittle, curled paper from the grass at the foot of the memorial. Rain had washed away most of the message. She read, "Bernice, we'll always remember." Then at the bottom, something about friends from Queensland. Queensland? She read a few more messages, even found an old, hardly recognisable photograph, and put it all together. Bernice Van Hoogen, an Australian from Melbourne, where Julia came from, had died in the hospital in Burgos 2 years ago. She was 73 and had walked the path 3 times. Maybe she came here to die, Julia thought. She knelt in front of the cross and looked at it. She didn't pray. Praying wasn't the kind of thing Julia did. She just looked. As a kid, she'd sit by the graves in the churchyard next to her house, trying to imagine who was buried in them. Sometimes she spent hours there, fantasizing about the dead rising and visiting her. It didn't frighten her at all. She thought they were her friends. She took a banana out of her pack and tried to imagine Bernice Van Hoogen while she ate it, but couldn't. Maybe she was too old for that kind of thing now. She turned as she heard the sound of a guitar coming from further back down the track. She thought, oh no, as Fabian came under the tree.
I will sing.
No, don't. Fabian hadn't exactly been following her, at least he said he wasn't, but had certainly always been around since they'd met in the square in Pamplona, showing up whenever she happened to be alone. He began to sing John Lennon's Julia.
I wish you wouldn't do that, Fabian. I can't help it.
When are you going to do something about that cold? He didn't answer, continued singing. She said, I'm finishing this banana, then I'm going. He stopped playing.
It's okay. I stop.
Everything's okay, Fabian. Just look at this beautiful day. Fabian lay back on his pack on the ground near her. He sneezed. She moved away.
I told you no one take it. I wish they would. I get it from the French man with the tent. You see him?
Yeah, I saw him. I gave him 10 euros. Said Julia. You want some bread? She felt in her pack.
No, mercy.
Fabian closed his eyes and let the sun play on his face. He hadn't shaved for a couple of months, but his beard was not a success, just made his round face look fluffy. He'd found another dealer in Logrono and wondered about making a spliff, but didn't know how Julia would take it.
I go to India, he said.
After Santiago?
No, I go already. I get Z's.
He plucked at his orange cotton trousers.
I was in ashram for 7 weeks. I meditate.
Yeah?
Julia turned, interested.
He tried to tell her about it, but his words couldn't match the experience. It had shifted something in him. He'd been a marketing manager for a sanitary ware company in Nancy. He'd done it for 3 years since leaving university, but was too bored to make something of it.
Who wants to work with pisspot?
He told her.
He decided to travel for a year and had gone to India with a friend. They'd parted company, and he'd gone to the ashram more because he didn't know what to do than for any spiritual reason. They taught him to meditate, and every morning he'd got up at 4 to practice it. At first, he'd found it impossible. The sheer physical pain in his legs as he sat immobile was almost unbearable. But there was an almost self-flagellating stubbornness tucked away inside of him that kept him there.
"I don't know what it was," he said. "I have good parents, good house, but something. Something was like a mountain in me, which I don't like."
He stopped as he thought about what he was trying to describe.
"My guru said it was the pain of being."
He grinned, then shrugged. After weeks of practice, the time had begun to pass more quickly. His teacher smiled at him. He began to notice that there were sessions when he lost himself and wondered if he'd fallen asleep, which was something he'd done frequently at the beginning. But after a while, he knew he wasn't sleeping. He knew because there was part of his mind that was watching him. He could see his anxieties rise in the purple clouds and dissipate as they passed through him and then being gently exhaled on his breath. What began as pain ended in air. By the 6th week, all sorts of feelings were rising up and disappearing, and he very slowly began to understand how to master them, not in any sense of repressing them or using them, but in being able to watch them, watch himself allowing them to go. It was as though he was caressing the kernel of his being with his breath, which had been something live, active, powerful. And as the air touched, so these faint clouds would form and rise like puffs of dust and disappear.
"I meditate 2 hours, he said. "Phew."
He wiped his brow.
"Blow my mind."
By the 7th week, he realized that this slow dissolution of self would take years, if not a lifetime. Because not only was there the past, the heart of what he was, there was also the day-to-day irritations and joys that seemed to take him 2 steps back for every 1 forward. He decided to leave. He only had 3 weeks left before his visa ran out anyway, and he wanted to go to the south. His teacher told him to practice. "It's not the end, but the way," she said, and he'd understood her. One thing was for sure, he was never going back to the sanitary wear. He returned to Nancy, given up his flat, sold or dispersed his possessions, and then began the Camino by walking out of his front door. He intended to go to Santiago and then walk back. He had the vague idea that he wanted to leave home and return with a gift. He knew what the gift was, too.
"C'est moi," he said.
Julia smiled. He didn't know if he could achieve it. His doubts were evident in the packet of weed sitting in the left-hand pouch of his pack. And now there was this girl, too, stirring up all sorts of feelings he thought he'd left behind. "My days are too full," he thought. "How can I ever be out of them?"
"I am Poland."
It was a voice they didn't recognize, then a laugh they would have known anywhere. They looked round and saw Oscar coming up the trail with the muscular Pole Peter had seen in the albergue. His name was Stanislav.
"No, I am Polish."
Oscar laughed again as they came under the tree.
"I teach him English. He is faster than me. He is non-existent."
Fabian had spent an evening with Oscar 3 nights ago in a bar in Najira, and the big Austrian, full of beer, with no Spanish and the locals' English, not to say German, as distant as London or Berlin, had managed to entertain them all for 2 hours on the subjects of alcohol and the benefit of becoming another person in your head. He'd been hilarious. Now it was Stan the man that was receiving his full attention.
"Polish?" Oscar repeated. "This is Fabian." "I am France."
"No. I am Australia," Julia laughed.
"Do not encourage him. He is an intelligent man. He knows."
"I am Korea." Chan was coming up the path towards them.
"I give it up for sea birds."
Chan dropped his pack and looked up to the sun.
"Catch the rays."
He started to take his shirt off.
"I am Germany. I surrender."
Oscar laughed loudly and sat down.
Stanislav dropped his pack and took off his t-shirt, revealing his well-developed torso. They all lay in the sun for a while, then Fabian began strumming his guitar, an old Beatles tune. Stanislav sat up and began to sing. He was word-perfect in English, even as far as faint Liverpool accent. Oscar turned, Julia raised her head. Fabian stopped playing. Stanislav continued singing. His voice was pure, and his enunciation exact.
"That's gorgeous, Stan," said Julia. "Do you know what any of it means?"
Stanislav stopped singing and grinned. He began to sing Sergeant Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band. Fabian picked up the tune on the guitar and they all joined in the chorus.
"You're amazing, Stan."
"Beatlesome, very good."
"Got another 10K to do today, fellas."
Julia picked up her pack. Fabian strummed Lennon's Julia again. Stanislav started to sing it.
"You're a cheeky chappy, Fabian."
Julia went down the path.
"I am in love with her," said Fabian, watching her go.
"You want tuna?" said Chan.
Fabian got up.
"I cannot eat. I will follow her behind, but my guitar will be silent, because she instructs me."
"His guitar gently vibes," said Oscar.
Stanislav began to sing it.